Right, hopefully that's worked. Does it say on your screen that we're live?
Yeah, saying it's live, yeah.
Excellent. Good afternoon, anybody who's watching. Welcome from me, and more importantly, welcome from CJ. CJ Wildheart.
Hello.
So we're going to ask CJ some questions, hopefully ones we didn't ask before, and watch some songs that we didn't watch before. So if anybody's got any questions, please send them in because they'll be better than mine. I'm going to start with the song, though. I'm going to start with The Robot, only partly because I've bought that record the other week. Do you want to tell us anything about it before I press play?
I mean, it came out a while ago. I tend to, like, the minute I release stuff, those songs are gone forever, and I might listen to them again maybe 3 or 4 years later. But that song is basically about anyone who works in a factory, on a production line, anyone who feels, ground down by the man. That's what the song's about.
Right, very relevant. Here we go.
Yep.
There we go. What a good way to start off.
I haven't heard that song in, like, literally in years. So I was actually listening to it going, oh God, I've completely forgot about that song. But it's funny because, like, literally in arm's length. This is the actual original robot. I mean, and it's not cheap as well. They're a couple of $100, these things. They're a bit a collector's item. But yeah, this is the original. Oh, I don't know if you can see him walking out there.
Is he going to walk? There he goes. Good job.
So the crap musicians have flying around. So put it right there next to my dildo collection. So
do a little plug for yourself to start with. Have you still got copies of the robot lying around? I know you were putting them on sale.
Actually, I think they're all sold out now. I think actually, you know, there's some. I think Mabel, my that sold out, and 13, I think, is sold out as well. And there's a few copies of Robot, a few copies of Blood. Get over to my shop if you want a copy, because once they're gone, they're gone.
Indeed. We'll have to plug the shop at some point. So I was going to ask you, how does your work when you name yourself CJ Wildheart differ from being in a band like in the past with Honeycrack and the Jellies, and even in the Wildhearts now? How do you see it as doing
different? I think, every band I was in after the Wildhearts, I was always known as CJ from the Wildhearts. So, and it actually the Wildheart tag was put on my name first to differentiate me from CJ Ramone. So back in the day, so there was CJ Wildheart, CJ Ramone. There was also a CJ in Baywatch, CJ Parker. And I didn't want anyone to confuse me with her, you know, which happened all the time in clubs.
I was going to say, did it happen a lot? Yeah.
Yes, you know, yeah, all the time. Yeah. But you're in a band, you're a musician, you know, and it's nice to be identified with a group, and especially a group as I think as good as the Wildhearts, you know. It could have been a completely different name after CJ. I won't slag off any bands.
Yes. How do you know when you're writing a song whether it's going to be a Wildheart song or a song for you to perform as CJ?
A lot of my solo stuff is a lot. It's very poppy. But if anyone has listened to my albums, there's a trajectory now where my stuff is getting heavier and heavier, and it's kind of, to be honest with you, everything I'm writing now is very aggressive punk, tinges of industrial. So the line is getting blurred now between my solo stuff and the Wildheart stuff. So whatever I'm writing can be either or. It doesn't really matter. I mean, I've just demoed up four, and I'm in the process of demoing up a fifth song, which are all for the next Wildheart album, but they could easily sit on a solo album as well. So,
because we're going to listen to Fubar later, and that has got the hard side to it as well as the very poppy side.
Yeah, but I mean, the stuff I'm working on now is even harder. I mean, it's kind of hardcore punk, you know. But
right,
to be honest with you, the way I feel as a person right now, the last thing I want to do is be doing this kind of melodic or just basic like rock and roll stuff. You know, I need to vent, and I vent through my music, and I think a lot of people need to vent at the moment. So, you know,
I was going to say, does that sound to the music come out of the situation we find ourselves in at the moment, and
yeah,
how you feel about the world?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, it's been an awful year for everybody. I mean, I've seen my girlfriend 3 days since lockdown. You know, I've seen her for 3 days, and you know, so there's a lot of frustration here, and I'm seeing her in you know about 10 days' time, but. You know, and also the homeschooling my son, which is really enjoyable. But the band has been, we've been fucked. You know, everything has been pulled. Everything has been, you know, the same with like everybody. But musicians aren't working. We're not touring.
Yeah.
It's a scary time. You know, our money's going to run out. And, you know, so we're wheeling and dealing, you know, at the moment.
Indeed. Well, one of the ways that you're wheeling and dealing is writing out lyric sheets. About the lyric sheet.
Can I ask you a question? Do you want to buy a watch?
Do you want to show us your blister? Show us your blister.
My blister? Which yes. one? I haven't seen my girlfriend in like, you know, I've seen her 3 days in the last 4 months.
So you've been writing out lyric sheets for ages.
I have.
And they're things they're beautiful things that fans love to have.
Well, it started off doing lyric sheets for the Wildhearts, and which kept on selling out as soon as I put my songs up, that sell out. But then I kind of like realized like, you know, the shit hit the fan that the Wildhearts aren't going to be touring, and you know, we can't be furloughed or anything, and there's only so much money in our central bank account to keep us afloat, and it was just like, right, I'm going to have to start helping myself here. And I have two managers, a manager who manages my solo stuff and a manager who manages the wild parts. I keep them apart, you know, for obvious reasons. And so I was like, right, why didn't you do a sale of your old stock, try and get rid of it? Because I was gonna take it to the dump, to be honest with you. You know. And then so I got rid of all that, but I said, right, I'm gonna have to bring back the chili sauce because I've missed my chili sauce and stuff. And you know, and so you know, but the lyric sheets are an extension of doing them for the wild parts, but my ones are printed and look nicer, and I've sold more as well.
Here's a picture of you hard at
Huh?
work from your social media somewhere.
That's all I've been doing for about, it feels like about 6 weeks. All I've been doing is writing out lyric sheets, and I'm a bit fed up of it, but I don't know. It's obviously I like the pain and the punishment of writing lines.
It is a bit
You
like
know,
rubbing
but
hands,
I'm
isn't
a
it?
couple of days away from being caned, so I'm really looking forward to that bit.
They do look beautiful. There's I go away written out.
They are, yeah, they are. They are really nice. This I can see some line over there, but I have nightmares about those things. I do.
Does it bring back the writing of the lyrics or the singing of the lyrics or the performing of the song when you're writing a particular one out?
Yeah, it does. I mean, it brings back a lot of memories, especially these three songs, because initially, you know, I only made available Lemonade Girl, Sitting at Home, and Go Away, and those three songs are quite old now, and yes, they bring, you know, they bring back memories. Like, and with Honeycrack and Jellies, it's mostly really, really good memories. There's a lot of fun I had with those bands, and both bands weren't together long enough for there to be any, you know, deep-rooted problems or there to be too much drama. It was just kind of like, you know, have a good time, a bunch of guys, you know, touring around the world and just, you know, getting on and enjoying themselves.
So there's Go Away. Here's Sitting at Home. That's quite a lot of writing in that.
There is, yeah. God, I'm getting a cold sweat now. I wish you'd stop showing me these.
There's only the one more, isn't there?
Look how neat that handwriting is, though. I mean that. I mean, if that ain't a serial killer's handwriting, what is? Or isn't? Someone asked me if I drew lines to keep it all straight, but it's just the way. I don't know. I have very neat handwriting.
And there's Lemonade Girl. Yes. So you managed to do that without drawing, without line guides, as we call them in the teaching profession.
Yeah, I just, you know, I have very neat and straight handwriting. Yeah, that's what I said. It's a serial killer's handwriting.
So did you enjoy handwriting lessons when you were at school?
I can't remember them, to be honest with you. I can't remember much of school generally. I did my last year and a bit in Britain, but before that, I was in army schools in Germany.
Right, yeah.
But when I moved back to Britain when I was 15, it wasn't the best time of my life, and I kind of blocked out a lot of it. You know, so I can't really remember. It was my only civilian school, yeah, I went to as well, because I was used to going to army schools, and it was a real shithole.
Well, I was going to ask you whether you thought you were a better student or a better homeschooler.
I was an okay student, but I left school with no qualifications, but that was due to me moving at an important stage in my life to a country I hadn't lived in for like 8 years, and you know, being hit with racism and shit like that, and you know, skinheads.
Yes, exactly.
But I enjoyed the homeschooling, but I'm quite strict,
Right,
and
with your boy,
because
yeah.
my son's like mother, who I get on really great with, my ex, we co-parent. She treats my 6 year, well, he's soon to be six next week, he makes turn six,
Well,
but
happy
she treats him
birthday.
like a little baby, like a 2 year old, and I treat him like a 60 year old. I'm really strict, and I'm quite like Victorian, but I think it's really good that he has best of
Different.
both. But I have a lot of fun. I mean, we play a lot, and I love computer games, and I love remote control cars and stuff. So does he. And you know, I'm getting him to respect motor vehicles because I love cars, and he helps me with cooking and stuff. And you know, so it's but I'm carrying lessons on even now through the summer holidays, because I thought, you know, every day there's a bit of English, a bit of maths, but there's a lot of play as well. But
Yeah,
you know,
that's the way
I
to do
think
it.
it's really good to kind of mix it all up every day.
So
So,
what would you say your favorite lesson to teach is and his favorite lesson to learn?
well, computer games, yeah.
Both of you. Both of you.
cooking when he sits at the table and watches me cook. But no, I mean, I'm really pushing him on English at the moment because it's something I wasn't really good at, and a bit of maths and stuff like that. But he has, I mean, it's I always ask him if he wants to learn about certain things. Like he wanted to learn about icebergs the other day, so we go to like the YouTube Britannica.
Yes, yeah.
YouTube's great for like, you know, he wanted to learn how cocaine was made. No, I'm joking. He wanted to learn how chocolate was made. So I showed him how chocolate was made. He wanted to see how a BMW was made and stuff. So I showed him how a BMW was made. And you know, stuff like that, if you're really interested, it's at your fingertips now, which is, you know, wonderful.
That is the ideal for education, in my opinion, following the child's interest.
Yes, yeah,
I don't know if you
definitely.
saw, there was a on the news, there was a 10-year-old boy who set up his own fanzine for his English project at
Oh,
home.
really?
He interviewed bands and so on. He's done a great job.
Well, that's really, I mean, Josh was on the, he was playing, he was six, he was playing, I can't remember, I think it was Grand Theft Auto 5. No, I'm joking. He was playing a racing car game, and he actually stopped playing it, and he logged into his homeschooling sort of app, started to do some math games on there. And that's really good because I haven't forced him to do that. And so he kind of knows that, you know, there's stuff out there which you can just have fun with, and there's stuff out there you can learn with as well. But he's good. He's good. He works off his own steam, and he's not one of those kids who needs 24/7 attention.
As a primary school teacher, that really cheers me up. That's a
Yeah.
great.
Well, he's really discovered rock music, and he's really discovered the fact my solo stuff and the wild art stuff now. And he actually, you know, I've caught him watching like wild art videos and
Interesting.
you know, and stuff. Yeah, so he's really, I mean, he's really, really aware of what I do for a living now, so which is great.
So I was just about to ask you if he's got any interest in music, making music, listening to music.
Loves rock music, and he loves the heavier the better. He's really into metal, but I'm trying to get him into punk. So and I mean, he loves that ska band, and what they call the Interrupters.
Right, yeah.
Yeah, he loves them. You know, we're a real great band though. So I'm getting, I've got him in, I've got him into the Clash, which is really good. So
So if he was interested in having a career in music, would you be pleased or would
chop
you
his
be alarmed?
fingers off.
Sorry?
I'll chop his fingers off.
Right.
I don't want him anywhere. I definitely wouldn't want him near someone like me. I was like all those years ago, and I definitely wouldn't. I mean, there's a lot of arseholes in the music business who play in bands and work with bands. And no, I wouldn't, I'll be really honest with you, I wouldn't want my son anywhere near a lot of the people I know. And you know, but he's gonna be at an age and he can make his own choices. One thing I will like him to do is move. And you know, I didn't grow up in one country, I grew up all around the world, and I've lived in many countries, and I'd like him to move, because I know far too many people who have never left this country, and you know, they've never really traveled and done anything outside of the UK. Beautiful country, but there's a whole fucking world out there, and I think
Absolutely.
people now realize,
Yes.
you know, what they're missing.
You've almost predicted my next question, which is what mistakes that you've made would you like to try to avoid your, would you like to help your son avoid? Not that you've made any mistakes, obviously, but
Made many mistakes, but I mean, I think kids these days, it's a completely different time. And it's, and you know, it's when I was a kid, and you know, especially when I was starting out in music, it was a lot easier for me to start out in music. I could just, you know, sign on the dole and go and do gigs, you know, and I wouldn't be forced to go and work. And I mean, I left school and I was on a thing called the YOP scheme or whatever it is, the
Oh,
YTS
yes, I
scheme,
remember.
made to go and work in a factory and shape metal and drill metal and stuff. So I did that for a little while, and then I got a job with a PA company, and then joined bands. And, you know, but I it's really important that the individual makes their own mistakes, and it's really, really important. It doesn't matter how long it takes, but you learn from them.
That's how you learn, isn't it? I'm convinced of that. Last question about him. Does he enjoy cooking?
He's starting to enjoy the pro. I tell you what, he really loves is making pizza, but I think all kids do. But he also notices that I spend a lot of time preparing food, and just when I'm making certain dishes, he notices that, you know, it's, there's a lot of love goes into it. So I think it's one way he can appreciate food is by seeing the fact that, I really, really love food. So that's going to kind of, by osmosis, that's going to hopefully, be
Indeed.
passed down to him as well.
Yes. Because I've seen quite a lot of photos of you cooking and so on social media. What have you got a favorite recipe that you'd like to tell us about?
Curry is my favorite food. So it's and I've been cooking curry for many years, but it's I mean, food for me is my main love. It's my it brings me. I mean, music was is way up there, but if I had to choose between music and food, I'm gonna go for food every time. I mean, food
Really?
and sex are really close together.
Yeah.
Music and sex, not so much, but there's a lot of sex around music, but I mean, food and love and just passion. I think they really, really go well together.
So
So
you're never tempted to go into food production as a job then?
oh no, I'm a punk rocker. If I was in a kitchen, I'd be smashing up, I'd be stabbing people.
Yes, there is that danger, isn't there?
Wow.
This is a late addition to my questions, which would you ever have eaten one of your own chickens, such as Mabel?
Would I?
Would you? I don't know whether you're
But they're
vegetarian.
not here.
Sorry?
I ate that with like a nice bit of like some chapati and rice.
Oh, you
So
did? I didn't get
no, I'm just
that bit.
listen. I didn't eat meat for about 10 years, but I swapped cocaine for steak.
Right.
I didn't
Great
start
plan,
eating
haven't
meat,
you?
I probably would have died.
Yeah.
So some poor cow saved my life. But if I had to, and I'm not one of those, I fish, and I only fish if I'm going to catch something I'm going to eat. I don't fish for fun. I don't see the point of pulling something out of a river, a sea, or a lake, and then putting it back in. You might as well club the thing to death and eat it. You've tortured it enough, put it out of its misery. But if I had to kill something to eat it, yes, I would do it. No qualms. I can't stand blood sports, and anyone who hunts for pleasure deserves to be hunted themselves.
That's pretty serious, but yes, I know what you mean. Is the satisfaction of a recipe completed? How does it compare with that of a song or an album completed and released?
Well, I don't. I mean, I cook. I don't really cook from. If I'm learning how to cook something, I'll follow a recipe. Then I always go off road and just cook. Most of the, in fact, all the dishes I cook, most of them I cook from memory. So it's not like. But for me, music's the same as well. If there's a lot of, I like all sorts of music, but some music's quite like dance music, which I love, and a lot of hip hop. It's quite regimented. Whereas the type of music like myself and Ginger makes, we can go anywhere. We can, we could have the most loveliest pop beer and then just drop something really ugly and dirty in the middle, and we can get away with it. So my cooking's the same as well. I'm not. I think once you start boxing people's creativity in, then you're stemming them, aren't you? You're stopping them from breaking out.
Yeah. Tell us a bit about this. There's lots of questions coming about this. Can you see it?
I know. Right. So my hot sauce, like my mum always made hot sauce. So I grew up with hot sauce, and she'd have hot sauce with every meal. So I mean, I started having hot sauce when I was a kid, I'm talking like 7 or 8. And I've always had spice. I've always had a hot sauce or chili flakes or something with most food I eat. And so I put an album, Mabel, out a good few years ago, and I thought, right, I'll do a hot sauce to come out with that album. And DevilSpit is my hot sauce brand. And the DevilSpit basically is beer, barbecue, and chili in a bottle. So there's ale in it, there's chipotle, which gives it that really like smoky flavor, and then there's chilies in it. It's three of my favorite things in a bottle, but it's just kind of stemmed from there. But for the last 2 years, I've been too busy with the wild arts, too busy being a dad. I've stopped making it, but I'm bringing it back because times are hard.
So
And
that'll be
if I'm at
available
that,
from
I'm
your
working
shop.
at McDonald's.
And that's going to be available from your shop fairly soon.
It's going to be on my online shop. I'm relaunching it next week. So August the 5th, I'm actually going down to the company who make it to do the first cook in 2 years, because we need to just make sure we get the initial recipe right again. And then I'm also bringing a ketchup back as well. So I've got the three strengths of DevilSpit coming back: mild, medium, and fucking hot. And then I've got a really nice kind of ketchup called the Blood Ketchup, which is named after my last solo album. That's coming back as well. And I don't know how long it's going to come back for, but you know, it's like when it launches next week, if you like hot sauce and ketchup, you better buy some because it might sell out.
Well, people are asking how hot the mildest one is, because
Oh,
people
it's not hot. I made it for girls and children. Yeah.
right.
No offense, girls, because I know some of you can take it really, really hot. But you know, I had to make a milder sauce because I didn't want you get a lot of guys, they have a bravado thing and they'll just eat the hot stuff just because they think they're hard, you know, but they actually want it quite mild. So Mojo looks really hot. And you know, if it's a guy out there who, you know, wants to impress the girls, he can buy a bottle of Mojo and glug on it. Yeah. They're gonna think he's a jackass, aren't they?
We're going to watch a video in a minute, but I'm just going to try and ask some of the questions that people have sent in, and then I'll have a look during the video for any more questions. So, John asks, how did it feel to play Hammersmith Odeon? Ginger sadly didn't look happy with it.
Actually, I can't remember. I think that was the second or third time we played there. So we played there before. We played there with Motorhead. I'm sure I played there with someone else
Right.
before. It's not my favorite gig. The Town and Country, the Forum in Kentish Town, is my favorite London gig. So I'd much rather play there than the Hammersmith Odeon. I've seen tons of bands at the Hammersmith Odeon, and it's always good when you play there. But yeah, the Kentish Town Forum is my favorite gig in the UK. Yeah. So and I'm a North London boy, so yeah, it means a lot more to me playing Kentish Town.
Couple of people just sending in greetings. Adam is saying hi from Southern California.
Hey Adam, you got that 50 quid I lent you 10 years ago? I want it back, man, or I'm sending the boys around.
Might need it, yes. And David is says, love the sunshine in Harrogate. You should be out enjoying an ice cream at the moment in Valley Gardens.
Yeah, I've just taken my barbecue out and I've got some coal, and once this is finished, I'm gonna have a barbecue, a one man pity fest barbecue. Yeah.
Where, I've lost the name. Someone, Joe Bowden says, looking forward to hearing your new stuff that you were talking about earlier. When can we expect to hear it, see it?
I'm hoping to drop an EP before Christmas. So I've got one more Wildheart song to record, and then I'm straight on to recording my EP. So that'll be hopefully four new tracks before Christmas.
Excellent. That's something to look forward to. Good, good. Johnny Rocker Billington says he loves his lyric sheet. Lots of comments about the lyric sheets, how much people like them. Somebody says, oh, I'd even buy a shopping list if you wrote it out. So next time you
Oh,
go shopping.
hey Johnny, hope you're good. Love to the family as well.
It was interesting what you were telling me earlier that actually you don't want to rip people off. It wants to be really beautiful. You don't want to be selling people shopping lists and.
No, well, I was saying some people just write on a bit of A4 and they scribble a signature and then they're charging people for that. And it's just like, there's just no way. You can't get away with that stuff. You can't rip people off. You have to give value for money. It's really important. Really important. But some people don't have a conscience, do they? So, you know.
Katie asked me to remind you how fanatical your fans are, which is interesting.
My fan or fans.
fans, I think.
They they're the most the Wildheart fans are the most loyal fans in the world. Really, I mean, they're famous. I mean, considering we're not a world known band, but you know, people who discover this band always talk about the fans and just say, you know, my God, you know, that is one fanatical movement.
Si says, what a pleasure it was to help you design the lyric sheets.
Oh, thank you, Sai. Thank you. I mean, you are really Sai is really talented. He's the guy who does all the wood burning tattoo things. But I mean, that actual lyric sheet's an actual frame, a picture frame. So if you ever get a chance, people look at Sai Easton's. I think it's called Wood Tattoos or something, or Wood Tattooing.
So if you want to post the link in the chat, that would be a good idea.
Yes.
Somebody's watching and cooking a pasta sauce with DevilSpit in it whilst watching.
Oh God! I mean, you know, I haven't had DevilSpit in a good couple of years. So part of bringing my sauce back is so I can have some as well because I really miss it. I know it's my own sauce and it's got my name on it, but it still tastes good.
To go back to the question about the new music, is it going to be physical or digital?
There will be a physical EP. It's called, I've got the name and everything. It's called a Skullhead EP. And I've even got the songs written as well. I just, it's just finding the time to record, and it's also school holidays now, and
Of course,
I've got my little 5-year-old. He's actually tied up in the corner at the moment, so he doesn't make a noise.
Don't tell your teachers that. Somebody called, claiming to be Paul Radish says, a question I was going to ask you actually, how many hats have you got?
At last count, probably about 25, maybe 30. I've got a few, but they disintegrate on tour, so but I do have a few. If you're gonna wear a hat, you should wear hats. You shouldn't wear the same hat all the time. Stink.
If anybody's after the link to size wood tattoos, he's put the link up now. So just click on that and like it would be really good. Barry says, "How did you have a rehearsal recently? How did it go?"
No, I don't. We did have a rehearsal. It went.
It went right.
It was, I tell you what, it was so nice to see Ginger and Richie. It was really, really nice to see them. Unfortunately, Danny couldn't make it, but it was great to see Ginger and Richie. Because I haven't seen them in so long. And the last time I saw Ginger was actually when me and Ginger were doing this.
Yes.
So it was lovely. And it's like we've been in a band for so long. I mean, me and Ginger started this band, what, 31 years ago? But and we've fallen out, we've fallen in, out, in, out. We've shook it all about. And it's just, it was really nice seeing those guys. They're good friends. And we're still on this journey, and who knows where it's going to go. But I tell you what, we get our shit together and record the new album, some killer tracks on
Well, we all look forward to that, obviously. Here's an older track that you chose. We're going to have a little break for a couple of minutes while we watch a song that you chose. It was, tell us why you chose Fubar.
Fubar,
Yes.
because it's kind of like where we're at the moment, isn't it? Actually, no, Fubar is about old musicians, the ones who are trying to recapture what they had back in the day. And it's about me.
Well, watch that. I'm going to be checking if there's any new questions. If you want to ask a question, it'll be a good time to do it during the song when I'm not concentrating so much on talking, which uses most of my brain. So here we are, Fubar. Fingers crossed it works.
Brilliant.
Here we go. great. Who made the video for you?
A guy called Ollie. He was the bass player in the support band on that tour. But actually, it's 7 days a week you lie to yourself. It's actually about Boris Johnson. Yeah. It was prophetic, you see.
Certainly is prophetic. Certainly is. I'd like to welcome people who've just joined. We're talking to CJ from the Wildhearts, and people who've been watching all the way through. I see Greg's just joined, and Paul, two people I know. Paul Jones.
Hello.
So that's nice. This is a totally free event, obviously, but if anybody feels moved to pay as if it was a gig, there's a link at the top of the page to Love Music, Hate Racism, which is a campaign we both support. We'll talk about that a little bit in a minute. First of all, though, I've got some more questions that have come in. If it's all right, I'll read through these questions and then I'll take any more that have come in at the end. So I'm going to scroll back a little bit because lots of questions came in. Two questions from both different Chris's, both about music and guitars and pedals. How's the Epiphone Dot working out for you live is a question.
It's brilliant. This is the guitar I got off eBay for, I can't remember, I think it was like £109 or something stupid. Yeah. It's a cheap guitar, but my Lucille, my main guitar, went missing. BA, they lost them when we were playing in Japan and they lost all our guitars. So I hired in the promoters hired me in this vintage Gibson 335 and I loved it. I went, well, I'd like to buy this. And it was like £7,000 and I'm not paying £7,000 for a piece of wood. I mean, come on. I mean, it's almost like car money. And I mean, anyone who pays £7,000 for a piece of wood, seriously, you need a slap, right? £1,000 maybe at a push, but you know, fortunate enough, I haven't bought a guitar since 1990 or something, you know, I'm sometimes a professional musician, so you get given a lot of stuff. So so I thought I'm going to buy a guitar. So I spent £109 on a guitar.
Does it sound all right?
It's awesome. I mean, I spent a bit more doing it up, and I have a deal with a pickup company called Bare Knuckles. I've got some of their pickups, had the thing set up. I had it filled in, some stuff all done to it. You know, it's heavily customized, but it went from a £109 guitar to a £124.99 guitar. So but it's great, I love it. It's the first guitar I've bought since 1991, I think, and it's just awesome.
I've got an Epiphone Dot downstairs, but it cost 200, so that was, I was ripped off.
Come on, man, you're posh.
Yeah, so here's another question about pedals. What pedals do you use live to get the awesome sound on stage?
I don't use pedals.
So the second part of the question is, are you running through the clean Marshall amp channel? I guess
not. No. I go straight into the master volume channel. I use DSL 100 watt H heads, and they're the closest I kind of can get that kind of nice kind of vintage tone, but with more gain. But I don't use pedals. No, I'm a plug in straight into the amp. I have a tuner. That's it. Yeah, but I don't use pedals and. Yeah, so, you know, anything which sounds like it's in effect, it's my magic fingers.
You're fantastic playing, yes. Good job. Simon asks a question that I've sort of asked you last time. Simon says, I've always wondered, how did you get on with the Manics? I know that was a long, long time ago now, 1992.
I tell you what, because that was quite a long tour.
It was, yeah.
Yeah, they were really shy. They didn't really speak to us for a good week. So I mean, we went down shit on that tour. I mean, they were like indie kids and pretend punk rockers, weren't they? And you know, so we were getting heckled a lot. There was a lot of fighting, and I think that they were kind of like, because the Manics, you know, that's kind of what indie punk, and you know, we were like a full on proper rock band, you know, and you know, we have punk elements, but you know, I think we're a little bit more intense than the Manics.
I remember reading a review at the time, because the Manics had the reputation for being the wild boys of rock, and it said, oh, in the backstage there's broken guitars and blood everywhere and sweat, and that's just with the Wild Hearts.
Were they ever the wild boys of rock, the Manics?
Or? I think they possibly were when they started off. There were quite a lot of riotous gigs.
Were they? Okay, Jesus. People are easily, intimidated then.
Well, they got
lovely bombs. Guys, though, I've got to say. Really nice guys. I mean, when they eventually spoke to us, they're really, really nice guys. And I've seen James off and on throughout the years, and he'll always come up and say hello. You know, mistakes me for ginger all the time, but you know, I made an impression.
Here's another specific question about another band. Is there any chance of you or the Wildhearts doing any Cardiacs covers for future releases? All right, Peter and Smith.
I think we'd ever become better players, haven't we? You know, the thing with the Cardiacs is that type of level of playing, especially the, I mean, I'm a big early Cardiacs fan. No offense to John Paul. I kind of stopped liking the band like when he was in them. But I mean, their original, even, I mean, their later stuff, the stuff they've done with John, it's virtuoso. It's out there. I mean, John Paul's like, without a doubt, the best musician has ever been in the Wildhearts. I mean, the guy is just unbelievably talented as a player and, you know, but you can see how good people had to be part of the Cardiacs. You need to be at John Paul's level of playing. And, you know, me and Ginger Punk Rockers, you know, we can do the metal thing, thrash thing, we can punk out. But, I mean, Cardiacs playing, I mean, that's prog rock. You know, I'll never be. I don't even want to be a prog rock player. I mean, that's like pure boredom, isn't it? Let's face it. But they're kind of, the Cardiacs was crazy, but oh God, I'd love to be able to be that good and play in the Cardiacs.
Here's a very good question, I think. It's in two parts, so hear me out. It says, how pleased with you and the rest of the guys with the finished Renaissance Man album and the reaction to it? Number one album in classic rock. So much kudos heaped on Diagnosis as a clarion call for mental health awareness and so on.
We, I'll be really, really honest. When we made the album, we had no idea how well it was going to be received, and how it was received blew us all away. I mean, it's like you come back after, you know, we hadn't had an album out for 10 years and you come back with an album and it can go over two ways. People could just say, oh, they're just riding on some nostalgia thing. But, you know, we stamped on people, you know, we came back and, you know, we gave people a good slap or a kick to the head. And that's what the Wildhearts should be doing. We shouldn't have come back, you know, stroking them. Yeah, right. We gave everyone a slap and including ourselves as well. You know, it was a wake up call, especially for me and Ginge, because, you know, we've been off doing other stuff and, you know, I think it reaffirmed in both of us, you know, that, you know, we started this band many, many decades ago, but, you know, we when we're on fire and when it's right, We're all right. We're a good band.
Yeah. I remember my friend Joel, who sadly he's going to have to watch this later because he's at work. So hi, Joel. He was saying how that first album made, how the most recent album made him feel. About how he enjoyed it so much. I can't remember the exact quote. Here's a couple more. There's loads of questions coming in, so I'm going to keep going through those if that's all right.
All right.
Have you got any recommendations for new bands, or are you listening to what stuff you know?
I don't get much time to listen to new music, if I'm honest. I mean, the last new album I heard was the Massive Wagon's latest one, which is brilliant, really, really good. So, but I think everyone's aware of them now. So, and that's a really good album. And then during lockdown, I really, really, I kind of discovered the Interrupters last year. And I'm not a fan of like ska punk per se, but the Interrupters have a bit more authentic sort of vibe going on, and it's they're really, really good. But I know they've been around for a few years. But it's like, I mean, today I was listening to The Clash in the car, you know, and you know, the day before that, what was I listening to? Cardiacs. I've been listening to a lot of Cardiacs since like Tim died.
Here's another good question. If the Wildhearts could go on tour with one of the major bands, I'm not that you're not a major band yourself, obviously, but one of the bands such as Metallica, Iron Maiden, Foo Fighters, and so on, who would you choose?
Metallica, Foo Fighters, then Iron Maiden, because not, I mean, that's how I'd go. But I mean, to be honest with you, I mean, Metallica were my favourite band when I was a teenager, and then after Master of Puppets, I just kind of, I've completely fell out of love with that band, and everyone kind of got into them. You know, all the people who used to like, just go, what is that rubbish, kind of got into them after, you know, that, what's that big album they had? I've never heard it. Is it the Black Album?
Yes.
What was that? You know, that's kind of, that was when they went nuclear, wasn't it? It was crazy, yeah. But I mean, for me, my favorite Metallica albums, Kill 'Em All, you know, and right. It always will be. But, You know, and the Foos, man, they've got some really good songs, you know, and you know, Colour and the Shapes are a fantastic album, and they've got some really good songs in it. I mean, Iron Maiden, I mean, I stopped listening when Paul Di'Anno was out of the band, so that was like in a, well, 100 years ago.
Yeah.
Nice guys, though. Lovely guys.
Will we ever see another CJ solo tour when these horrible times end?
You will, yeah, definitely. I mean, what I'm working on now is trying to do like a live stream gig, hopefully before the end of the year, which will be a solo live stream gig. So I'm working on that now. Not acoustic, it will be an electric gig, but I'm figuring out if I'm going to do it with a full band or just another guitarist and have the drums and bass backed up. So I'm trying to figure out the logistics. And I will do another solo album, and I will put a band together, and I will tour again, definitely.
Here's a question about Red Dwarf. Apparently you said in the past that you love a bit of Red Dwarf. Have you seen the recent special episode? And if so, what do you think? Do you think it's a bit like the Wildheart still going after all these years?
I had no idea. I saw the last season, which was on, I think, a couple of years ago, but I had no idea they did a recent special. So I'm going to have to dig it out. But yeah, Red Dwarf's like, when I first saw that show, I started watching it when it was first broadcast, but it reminded me of a band just being in the studio on a tour bus, because it was these four guys who kind of get on and don't get on, and just there's a lot of boredom being in a band, and I could kind of connect with that show straight away. But I mean those early seasons are just absolutely amazing. I mean, I've just still got a huge, huge soft spot for that, so I'm definitely gonna check that new special out.
Have you got any plans for online gigs? Somebody asks.
Yes, I just said I'm in the process of putting together like a solo online gig, but it won't be an acoustic.
No, that's not the acoustic one. I see what you. Yeah. Sorry, I was reading the other questions.
Right. I can't do a show on my phone.
No.
You know what I said about value for money?
Yes. Yeah. Yes, I'm just trying to work out how we can do decent online gigs as well. But I know what you mean, yes.
Yeah. Right. The kitchen ain't big enough for me to do a show in.
Lots of good questions coming. I'm going to go back to some of mine, and then at the end, if there's any more, we'll keep going another few minutes if you've got a few more minutes until you go to the barbecue. So
my steak's getting up to temperature, it's all right.
Smell it. Yeah, well, as long as it's not Mabel, that's all right. So, as I say, we've got a link at the top of the page where people can donate to Love Music Hate Racism if they choose to. I was going to ask you a bit about Black Lives Matter, because that's become a worldwide event since we last talked. What are your thoughts on it? Do you think it's a permanent shift towards equality, or do you think the bad ways will reassert themselves?
I can tell you stories my folks obviously aren't British. My dad's, you know, Indian, but he's from South America, British Guyana. Mm-hmm. Which is the north of the West Indian, like Caribbean side of South America. My mom's from the Seychelles. And when they moved, my mom and dad were both in the British Army, because both their countries were colonies. And they met in London in the 60s. But when they were a couple trying to find places, I mean, the amount of doors they had slammed in their faces, and you know, because they weren't, you know, they were a couple of color, and you know, you'd find most people have some story. I mean, I remember when I moved back to Britain after being out of this country for 8 years, when I was 15, and I grew up in the military, so I went to army schools, and I went to my first civilian school when I was 15, and in Essex. And I remember the skinheads, you know, just the greeting I got for them. But I'm quite a mouthy person, and I stand my ground. And you know, I'll be candid here, you know. But they basically said, like, "Fuck off back to bad dad, you packy," right? And this is the greeting I got. And then I turned around to them and said, "There's two problems with that, you know." And I was brutal, and I said, "Well, A, I'm not a packy, right? B, Baghdad ain't in Pakistan." And their faces, they just dropped, because they've never seen a brown person talk so like at them like that. And then I said, "Right, well, what are we going to do about this?" And they were shocked. And then I actually became friends with a couple of these guys. You know, I think they'll pretend right wing sort of skinheads, but years later, I actually became friends with them, and they kind of apologized for their behavior, but they said they'd never ever seen a kid like an Asian kid like me. And I said, "What do you mean?" He goes, "Oh, most of the kids would just run away, or we'd give them a slap and they'll cry. And you actually stood your ground and came at us." And they were it really intimidated, it shocked them. But I can't tell you the amount of times I was stopped by the police, as a especially when I'd hired nice cars. And I'd be pulled over, and they'd on. I mean, I've been pulled over because they thought I'd stolen cars. I've been pulled over because they thought I was a suspected rapist, me and my brother. There was a couple of brown guys going around picking up white girls. We had our two girlfriends in the back seat. They pulled over, and I mean, stuff like that. The amount of times I've been stopped in search for, drugs, being a drug dealer, but everyone has got these stories. What happened in the States was really, really bad, but I think it got hijacked by people who weren't. It could have turned into something really, really good. What it's done is inflamed the far left and the far right, and that isn't good, because there is a far left. People always go on about the far right, but there is a far left, and their mindset is exactly the same. They're as extreme as each other. And it could have, and it still can become something good. But you most people have a story about it, especially an Asian like me, or a Jamaican or an African American. They have stories, and it goes on. And hopefully the world will get better. But do you think it's getting better right now?
I think it's in the balance, isn't it? I think it can go either way.
I think it's going to take a lot more than toppling over statues and stuff like that. The nice gestures and that, but I think it's going to take a lot more, and people have to be a lot more diplomatic. A lot more diplomatic. I don't I
What
think
do you think musicians can do to help make the change for the better?
the musicians just need to write good songs and go on stage and do good shows. It'll take more of a musician. It takes a conscious effort from the masses, but when things get extreme, your flame, you ignite a fire which is really, really hard to put out. And that's what I said. You need diplomacy. Yeah, you need to be more. You need to keep your emotions in check, and you need to be more. You just need to be smart about these things. You really do. But I've got a story to tell. I just ain't. I had a song called 50% Indian. It's about people being shocked that I didn't smell a curry when I came to this country. And there's a line in there that say, I don't have any money, I don't smell a curry. I smell really nice. Sometimes I'm walking down the road going like, God, what's that really nice smell? And it's like, oh shit, it's me.
Here's a much more serious question, and it's coming from Josh, your son. He says, what's your favorite animal?
Josh, my son.
Apparently, yes. Sasha says it's.
Oh, he's with his mum at the moment. My favorite animal, my favorite baby animal is a bear cub. A bear cub. It's good. Bear cubs just look like, I don't know, look like they're going to have a little zip down the back of them, and this little person is going to come out of them. But I love all animals,
Well, if
especially
he's
a chicken
interested,
curry sauce. Yeah, lovely.
badgers are my favorite animal, if Josh is interested. If you're in my class, you have to talk about badgers pretty non-stop, unfortunately. How do you feel when you look back at the different bands you've been involved with? I'm going to try, if I can organize myself, show you some pictures and of some of the bands you've been involved with, just to give you a quick chance to reminisce. Oh, this is what I asked you about earlier. This is Top of the Pops, isn't it? In the
Oh,
West.
that's, yeah, caffeine bomb, yeah.
I'll try and make that a bit bigger if it will go bigger. No, it won't. I couldn't even recognize that was you.
Well, yeah, as I was saying, because after I did that, because I put white face on, I mean, it was so controversial at the time that you had a brown guy actually putting white face on. Yeah, I wasn't allowed on Top of the Pops for at least another 6, 7 years. They banned me. Yeah.
So I've got a couple of snaps from there. I mean, you're all there. It is. What was it like doing Top of the Pops? Was it as weird as everyone
No,
says?
I mean, the first time we did it, it was really weird because it was filmed next door to, it's an L Street, and it's filmed next door to the EastEnders set. So when you're sound checking and everything, you've got like the Mitchell brothers and stuff like in there looking at you sound check. And when we broke for like lunch, I remember standing in the queue with like Barbara Windsor and Pat St. Clements and just chatting with them because we had to keep this stuff on, you know, and they're just all the other people going, you're like a 70s glam rock band. And it's just that we haven't seen anyone like you here in years. But it was a real experience because seeing the Mitchell brothers and stuff when you're eating and all these people you see on TV. But it was, I mean, your first time on Top of the Pops is always, you know, it was a major milestone in any band's career. And you know, I just remember how proud my folks were and you know, all my friends and stuff. So yeah, it's a really, really good memory.
Did some genuine Wild Hearts fans get in? I saw some people with Wild Hearts t-shirts on at Catherine Vaughan.
In the, I think they used to invite fans of like certain amount of fans of each band into the show. I can't remember, it was such a long time ago.
It was, wasn't it? I can't remember what the next picture is. Oh yes, Honey Crack.
Yeah, that's, I mean, again, I mean, a band. I was really that Honeycrack album. It's for me. It's like one of it was such a musical album, and I'm really, really proud to have been a part of the band. And just I learned so much in the few years I was working with Willie Dowling, and you know, taught me a lot. And if I don't, I mean, if I hadn't been in Honeycrack, I don't think I'd be recording my own music. You know, I record all my solo albums myself in my own studio, and then go elsewhere and add drums, get a drummer in and mix it elsewhere. But really kind of put me on that journey of, you know, making music for yourself and cutting out, you know, the middleman.
I think that was in Bedford Esquires. I'm looking at the picture. Oh, there you are with red hair. Yes.
Look at my eyes.
The
Yeah, hay fever.
red hair, red t-shirt, and red guitar. That's the jellies.
You showed these pictures before, didn't you?
I did. I thought them up some different people, yes.
I'm looking like I'm in pain. I think I probably had hemorrhoids that day. By the looks of it, I do look like I'm in pain, don't I?
That's the smallest gig I've ever seen you do. And then, yeah, what's this about? Were you very big in Japan?
We weren't really big, but we had a big record deal in Japan, and so we did a lot of promo out there. And I mean, we went out. I think we didn't go out that many times. I think we went out like four times, but it was good. It was a lot of fun. A lot of fun. And you know, every time you go to Japan, you have a great time. It's such a great, wonderful country to play. And you know, who knows when we're going to go back there again.
Somebody asks, being inspired by the Honeycrack pictures, would you ever do a Honeycrack reunion tour? Asks Ben. It's the band I'd most like to see again more than any other.
I think there was a time, there was a period when we could have got back together, but I think right now, you know, I'm way, way too busy to take on anything else, you know. And you know, my main band is the Wild Hearts, and you know, if there's one thing I'd really love to do is to get a new album out and for all this shit to go away in the world and for us to start touring again. And then, you know, right now also, I'd rather put out a solo album. You know, it's just, you know, but you know, you never say never.
That's a picture of a gig you did for me for Love Music Erasing. I'm going to put that
How
there.
long ago was that?
That was 2007.
Right.
And I just wanted to picture the guitar there because I wanted to know. Well, I teach. There was a boy I taught last term who had a pink guitar, and he almost stopped playing because it was pink. And then we found out the cost of respray was massive. I said, cover it in stickers. How did you do that?
We just, I mean, we had one sticker and two stickers, and then we just started acquiring stickers, me and Ginger, and it just kind of was just a thing. It stuck,
It
you know.
looks great. It looks great. Oh, where did I get that picture from? Chris Watkins took that picture.
It's a really good picture, that.
It is.
I mean, as I'm getting older, I actually, when I was younger, I used to move a lot on stage, and then I went through a kind of cool, mellow period for about 20 years. But as I'm getting older now, I just want to move more and just pose and just, you know, kind of just really embrace the fact that, you know, we're not kids anymore. We're older, and we can still jump and run around and sing. And it's a really nice feeling being able to just go on stage and give it 100%.
There's another hat.
I have a few.
You have a few. It's rumored to be true. And then I think, oh, yes. Oh, I don't know
That's
where.
my £120 guitar or £109 guitar there.
Is it?
Yeah.
Nice. Nice. And then keep thinking is the. Oh, there's, we've talked about the source. There is one more picture, which I'm trying to shoot through to find. This, here we go. Robot was number two. Is that right? In rock albums?
Was it?
Apparently. I don't know where I found
Oh,
this.
brilliant. Well,
Yeah.
that's nice to know. I should have paid
Yes.
more attention at the time.
18th March 2016. It was
Wow.
a rock album.
That's really good. It's really, really good considering, I made the album in my bedroom. But saying that, the drummer on this album is a guy called Jason Bold, who he's I mean he used to be in a band called Pitch Shifter. I think he plays with that metal band. Is it Bullet for My Valentine, I think they're called.
Oh yes, yeah.
Yeah, but he a man, geez, he plays on Blood as well. I mean, he is just, I mean, he's a drummer tour de force, man. He's outrageous. Whoops.
More questions, and then we'll wrap up. I've got a couple, and I'll look and see if anyone else has put any more questions in. Is there any more Wildheart stuff coming out? I saw a post from Ginger. Is there a live album coming out
There
on?
is a live album, yeah. I mean, it's coming out on Ginger's label, Round Records. I have no idea when it comes out. I think it comes out in September, but I mean, it sounds brilliant, and it's—I mean, it's a really, really good album. So, I mean, that's the next sort of Wild Arts thing, and then we're hoping to start recording the next album, by October time.
Wow,
That's the plan.
that is
So we
exciting.
need to kind of like we've the actual album's written. We just need to basically during lockdown, myself, Ginger, and Richie demoed up songs or wrote songs, and from that writing demoing process, we've got 14 songs, which we just need to get into the rehearsal studio and kind of knock into shape. But the album's written. We just need to knock them into shape, get in the studio, and record it.
Well, that sort of fits with the question I was going to ask you, because I work with quite a lot of young bands, and they, if you've only just started and then the whole thing shuts down, the small venues they play are shut down, and there's no sign of when they're going to open again, how do you think they can keep like motivated and on track?
Or they, I mean, everyone, most musicians now are using this time to write and work, and you should be. I mean, if you've been locked down for months and months and you haven't written a song, you are the laziest motherfucker on earth. You cannot call yourself a musician. You cannot say, because there was 3 months when the world was stopped. Unless you're out there as a key worker, you weren't doing anything. And if you're a musician and you don't write songs during lockdown, I'm saying this, you're a lazy cunt. You don't deserve to call yourself a musician. You really, really need to like get a grip, because it's like it was the perfect time for everyone to write songs. And I think next year when everything opens up, there's going to be so many new albums out there, and there's going to be some great albums. But people have used this time to to be really creative, and it's you're turning a bad situation to something really, really good.
Here's a good idea from Paul. He says, how about a Wild Hearts festival? Every band, you, Ginger, Danny, Rich, and everyone else has ever been in playing over a weekend. It might be a bit hard for you lot.
You imagine all the rehearsals? We'd have to rehearse it up for a whole year. Some people, it's funny, it's like, oh, why don't you just do that? It's like, yeah, we'll just fly in and play. When you haven't played like songs in like 20 years, you've got to learn them and rehearse them. I mean, it'd be great. I mean, I think a Wild Hearts festival would be really good as long as it isn't in Scarborough. We did one in Scarborough once, it was a disaster. But things like that, yes. I think it would be better if we did like a kind of tour, kept it in smaller venues, and maybe had bands we were associated with. Yeah.
Right, we're almost finished. Is there anything you want to remind people about what you're selling?
Just that, I mean, we're not touring at the moment, and all bands are kind of not touring at the moment. So you're seeing a lot of people wheeling and dealing. Some people are doing their acoustic shows in their kitchen sitting rooms and room. I've been backed into a corner now where I have to like push my solo thing again. So, as I said, I'm doing lyric sheets and stuff like that. I want to get an EP out, but I launch my sauce next week. And if you like chili sauce, just check it out, because it's I'm a chili head, so I'm not going to produce anything which is this isn't regular ringing swords, man. This is like proper stuff. All right. So, no offense, Levi, man, but you know, you must keep the good stuff for yourself.
So
But,
that's a minimum shot.
and just, you know, promote and support all your smaller artists, because we you know, if we don't tour, we don't earn. We're not touring at the moment, and there's a million and one small artists out there, you know. Just promote us and support us in any way you can, even if you're just listening to our music on YouTube, or you know, getting people to hear our music. You're doing a really, really good job, and you know, I can't thank you enough.
And the traditional final question, I know I asked you a few weeks ago, see if you've changed your mind. Chips or cream buns?
Was that question?
Chips or cream buns, which do you prefer?
What did I say before? It must have been chips, wasn't
It was chips, yes.
it?
Probably with sauce, as in sauce.
Cream bun. Yeah, I'm not a creamy, I'm a chocolate person, man.
Right.
Yeah.
Excellent. Well, thanks everyone for watching. It's been great. Loads of comments and so on. The whole video is going to be on YouTube later, but it will also stay on the Facebook page. I know there were several people who wanted to attend and weren't able to, so we'll put that up for them. Thanks to anyone who's been able to donate to Love Music Hate Racism via the link at the top of the page.
That's really, really cool. Yeah.
And especially thanks to CJ for your time. It's really nice to see you again and see you.
I mean, thank you everyone, everyone who like kind of just watched me, thank you. And yes, we will be back. The Wildhearts will be back. I'll be back. You know, it's a hiccup in the grand scheme of things, but
Exactly.
we will be back.
We're going to finish with Honeycrack on TFI Friday. Partly the reason I chose this song is because the first line is, "I don't want to be here breathing your infected air," which made me think of the current crisis.
Yes, yeah.
Anything you remember about doing TFI Friday?
Yeah, actually, I mean, Chris Evans was a massive fan of the band, so, and I think, yeah, Go Away was like single of the week on Radio One for about 2 weeks running on the breakfast show, and so it was quite a big deal for us. But he asked us to do the pilot for TFI, which we did,
Yes.
and then obviously they asked us back on the show. But yeah, I mean, talk about driven and like workaholic and kind of, I mean, I've never seen anyone as driven or as like just that focused as Chris Evans, man. The guy was like, I mean, he's a dragon. A
Well, here we
proper
go.
guy.
This is the best audio quality I could find of that performance, and it does have the video as well, just after a
Brilliant.
second. Thanks everyone for watching. Wash your hands.
Thank you.
Take
God
care.
bless.
Here we go.
Breathing your infected air. I'm happy to ignore you and pretend that you're not there. Don't make me speak my mind. I can tell that you won't like it. Yeah. Do you risk your life on accusation? I wouldn't. If for tomorrow, for tomorrow, I think I'll get away. Giving your opinion, which I've chosen to ignore. Endless contradictions, Christ, you're such a mindless bore. Go!
Right. Thanks, everyone. Also, should say thanks to Ben and Callum for helping your management company. Cheers.
Awesome. That was great, that.